Yes, sir.
So thank you, Brother Fontaine, for taking time out of your busy schedule. I know, as usual, you got a lot going on, helping our minister, Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, but I wanted to take a few moments out of your time. One of the things that I've reflected on is that in many instances, we talk about the enemy writing us out of history.
Yes, sir.
But we're not as doing as good of a job as we could.
Yes, sir.
Making sure that we stay in history.
Yes,
so
sir.
In part, this is a discussion that I've been, did a few interviews with believers that
yes,
you would be amazed that anybody that's been in the nation for any length of time.
Absolutely.
If it's 2 years, 3 years,
got a story to tell.
They have many stories to tell.
Yes,
and
sir.
Of course, you've been around a little bit longer than 3 years. So
yes,
just
sir.
Want to first start off with, you know, a question that's interesting, that responses that I've gotten, not necessarily when you first came in the nation,
yes,
but
sir.
When was the first time you recall hearing anything about the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad?
That's a very interesting question. Let me start it this way. Firstly, Brother Troy, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this honor. You know, I've loved you since I met you in the Nation of Islam, and I've actually fallen in love with you as my brother. You're one of those who, if I had to get into the battle, I could get back to back with and really not look behind me and go to war.
Praise
in the
Lord.
Name of Allah, His Christ, and our beloved servant and the true believer. So I'm honored to be with you. So it's a kind of an interesting backdrop, because I kind of can say it like this as I've thought about it over the years. I think I first heard the teaching, I was in high school, and I was searching. You know, mother died when I was very young. I was 11 years of age when my mother made her transition, and my father pretty much had a mental breakdown and he disappeared. And so the semblance of the home that we had with me, my baby sister, and my baby brother was pretty much destroyed. And so we moved in with our maternal grandmother, and her home was a lot different than the home that we were in, although we were in a very rough environment with the drinking, the smoking, the ghetto life as we live as black people. But to go from a semblance of a home to a home where we were living with 30 and 40 people at a time, it changed our dynamics in a very serious way. So I've been a big brother since I was 5 years of age, and that was my basic destiny in life, was to be a big brother. That's what I've done, that's what I love, that's what I enjoyed. So when my mother passed, I fell into that role which I had been in since I was five. So when I got to high school, I was searching, looking for somebody, looking for something, just not understanding life, but just looking. My uncles, who I had loved, many of them were in jail. My father had been going in and out of jail, so things were very unusual at that time. So when I got to high school, Allah began to steer me in certain ways. So I picked up my first book one day in the library, and I figured out I had the ability to travel. Literally, I could get into that book.
Mm-hmm.
And the first book I picked up was called The Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison.
Yes, sir.
And when I read that book, I realized at that point as a ninth grader that I could literally get into the lives of those characters. And I found myself in the ring when he was fist fighting, and he was given those letters of just total distrust, and they were steering him in all of these different directions. And every person who he gave the letter was simply saying, do not give him a job. Keep the nigga running, in so many words. And I literally was in his foot. I could smell the food, I could do this and I could do that. And I really realized then that even though I was in this terrible state, I could read a book and travel. And so I began to set on vacant doorsteps, if you will, in Baltimore. We call it like a city of steps.
Mm-hmm.
Marble is everywhere. So a lot of abandoned homes. I would take a book, go around the corner, sit on a step, and I would read for hours. So as I went from Invisible Man to Man Child in the Promised Land, I actually picked up the autobiography of Malcolm X. But as I read it, I never understood that this was a real nation, if you will. I was kind of ignorant to what I was really reading, but the seed of Islam went into my mind as a result of reading the autobiography of Malcolm X. Then I had an uncle, one of my favorite uncles on earth. His name is Uncle Dennis, and he's made his transition recently.
Mm-hmm.
But he was an uncle who was in jail for murder. And when my uncle came home from jail, he used to take us on these long runs, me and my cousins, my brother, my sister, and we would run all over Baltimore, through the woods, in the streets. And my uncle would literally be like, well, we live for Muhammad, we die for Muhammad, huh, it's in my blood, huh, it's in my blood, huh. So as I've gotten older, you know, I realized that Islam was subtly being placed in me, but I didn't have any idea of what that was. So long story short, I'm in college, I'm a freshman. And I was in management at the time at a shoe store called Pick and Pay. And when I was in high school, they had a program called the School of Work Transition Program. And I went along with about 15 other students to interview. And I was chosen out of these 15 students, and I was given an opportunity to work 20 hours in this program. Mm-hmm. And the manager, who was my first manager, who took me under his wing, his name is Wade Coates. I'll never forget him, and I've never spoken to him since I left Baltimore. I can't find him, if you will. But he was like a ghost, but he was real. And he's the first one who taught me how to work 14, 15, 16, 18 hours a day. So he was a go-getter. He was one who, when a store was in bad shape, they would call him. And he would go in and transform that store and bring it back to life. Well, once I graduated, the district manager came to the store. I'll never forget him. His name was David Broweranker. And he came to the store and he said, "Fontaine, I heard you graduated." And I said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "Man, I'd like to make you an offer." And I said, "Yes, sir, I'm very interested." And he said, "How would you like to be a manager?" And I said, "Man, I'd really love that." So I went from making $8 or so an hour to becoming a manager, making, I believe, $400 and some odd at that time, with the potential for a bonus. But there was a catch. The catch was I had to go to a store in Gaithersburg, Maryland, which was roughly an hour and a half away from Baltimore. And so I said, "Of course I'm willing." And so he said, Wade Coates, who was my manager, was going to go with me. Wade would take me to and from work every day, and he would train me up, and he would give me an opportunity. But the catch was, in less than 6 months, no more than 6 months, I had to have my own car to be independent. Man, I was so honored. I took the opportunity, and that journey began. Well, here I am on the college campus one day, and I'm seeing these beautiful brothers in fatigues, marching, doing all of these different things. And I was intrigued, and they were strong, and they were muscle built, and these were some serious disciplined men. And I'm looking like, man, who are these brothers? And I finally got the courage to ask them who they were. And the brother told me, he said, "Man, I'm a member of the Omega Psi Phi, just the Q Dogs." Mm-hmm. And I was like, "Really?" And he was like, "Yeah, you know." And he was like, "Man, how you wanna learn more about it?" And I was like, "Yeah, I'm interested." And so he said, "Meet me in the library after class. We're gonna have a secret meeting over here." So after class, I went and I met them in this library at Coppin State. And the brother was very beautiful. There was a lot of them. And so they told us we would have the baddest line. I didn't know anything about line. I didn't know anything about attorneys. I didn't know nothing about nothing. I'm a little boy from the ghetto. Didn't know nothing about nothing. We grew up so poor, dear brother. We never had cable. We didn't have, I mean, we barely had a TV. I mean, I'm one of those who came up where gas and electric was like a thing of the past, where our gas and electric was connected. Not like it here in Chicago, where you have ComEd and People's Gas. When ours got disconnected, your gas and electric was disconnected simultaneously. So we grew up like that. Every winter, our gas and electric was disconnected, and we lived in that type of cold, crazy environment. So anyway, I said, "Okay, brother, I'm interested." So he said, "Man, we're gonna have the baddest line that Coppin State ever produced. You're gonna be the shortest Q." And there was a brother who was about 6'5" or 6", and he's gonna be the tallest Q. "And we're gonna have the baddest line that Coppin State ever produced." I said, "Man, I'm interested." So imagine this, I walk out, then the brother said, "It's $1,500 to join." But I had that because I was managing and didn't have no children. I'm 20, mm-hmm. barely going on 20. I may have been almost 20 or very close to 21. And the reason I can't tell you specifically is because it was the spring of 1989. My birthday is on March the 22nd, spring mm-hmm. begins on March the 21st. So I don't know if I had just turned 21 or I was about to turn 21 or I was a little after 21. But the long story short, after I left the meeting, this is the God's honest truth, I come out, I had just been blessed to get my first car, brand new, 1988 Chevrolet Spectrum, four-door, baby blue, no miles, I'm in heaven. I jump in my car, Brother Troy, and I turn it on. And for the very first time, I hear the voice of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Now, I'm a brother who, and I'm not bragging, I have a gift of memory. There's certain things that I can remember as though they're happening in real time. And as I'm in the car, I hear the minister's voice, but I can honestly tell you, I cannot remember one syllable of what he said. But what he said was so powerful to me that the next thing I remember saying was, "Good God Almighty, who is this?" And as the words came out of my mouth, the announcer came over the radio. I believe it was Minister Jamil, who was the student minister of the city at that time. Mm-hmm. May not be him, may have been the announcer, but the short story, he said, "Minister Louis Farrakhan comes to Baltimore via satellite. Come to 3013 West North Avenue and get your ticket right now." It was like a command from the Lord of the Worlds. Now, Coppin State College is in the 2500 block of West North Avenue. I had never seen a member of the nation. I had never seen a brother in a bow tie. I had never seen an MGT. I didn't know anything about any of that. Brother Troy, I took off down the street like God had instructed me, as God is my witness. And I was less than, again, 5 or 6 blocks. I got to 3013 West North Avenue. The car was on the right side of the street. You had to cross over to get to 3013. And I walked inside of the building, and there was a brother behind the door. Later, I learned his name is Brother Robert. But I said, excuse me, sir. I said, man, may I meet Minister Farrakhan? And he said, oh, no, brother, Minister Farrakhan is not here right now. He said, but that's his picture over there. And Brother Troy, I walked over to the picture, and I looked at the picture. And I actually feel like crying. It's so serious, and it's so real. But I looked at the picture, brother, and I said, good God Almighty, this man is beautiful. And I'm just standing there looking at the picture. And then the minister's playing in the background. He had his tape connection is where I was. So then I said, man, I said, you got the ticket to see Minister Farrakhan? He said, yes, sir. I said, can I buy one? How much are they? He said, $10. I bought my ticket. Then I said, you sell these audio tapes everywhere. This audio and video back in that day. So I said, you sell these? He said, yes. How much? He said, $10. I said, well, which one would you recommend? And he gave me my first audio tape entitled Diamonds Among Men. And I got that audio tape. And by the time I got to my job, which was an hour and a half away, I was done. You know, I'd heard the voice of the man that I had been longing for all the days of my life. And by the time I got to the job, brother, I was on a whole nother game. I was done. And I never went, it's so funny when I think about it, because at that point, that was it. And then I'm listening to the audio tape every day, all day. And then I became an audio tape junkie. So every day I'm at the store, I'm looking for new tapes. And sometimes they would be closed and different things. I'd be outside banging on the door like, man, you can't be, where they at? Like, God dang, you can't be not in here. Like, I need a tape. Like, I was on drugs almost. And my love affair with Islam began right there, listening to the minister's voice. And I never returned to any, like the fraternal life, I never even thought about it again. It's like literally when I think about it now, I never ever saw them again, Brother Troy. The brothers who were in the Q-Dog fraternity, I never heard from them again. I never saw them again on the campus. It was all about this truth. It was all about the minister. It was all about the God that he represented and the Father, the eternal Father of this nation that I know now is the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So that's how I actually heard the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and my journey in the nation began. As I'm going back and forward to the tape connection to close that point, one day, I'm on a Monday night. I'm going to the tape connection to get my fix, my audio tape. And a beautiful brother, I mean, literally the smile of an angel. His name was Brother Al. He was the first officer. I didn't know nothing about titles. I didn't know nothing about none of that. Mm-hmm. But this brother saw me, and he saw me coming in and out every now and then. And he said, man, what's your name, brother? And I told him, Brother Fontaine, and so forth. And he said, man, what you doing tonight? Would you be my special guest? And I said, for what? He said, man, it's a men's class tonight. He said, man, I'd really love for you to come and be my guest. Would you do that? And I said, yes, sir. What time does it start? Now, I was in a shirt and tie, but he was in street clothes because he was a HVAC repairman. So he was dirty and, you know, he was just coming home from work. So I was like, yeah, I'll do it. And he said, you'll be here at 7 o'clock. I said, I sure will. Brother, I came at 7 o'clock to my first FOI class. The first brother who I saw is a beautiful brother. His name is now Student Minister Tracy Muhammad. He's the student minister in Richmond, Virginia, Muhammad Mosque number 24. But the first time I saw him, he was handsome, tall, light skinned hair, beautiful, cut you know, with a part like the minister, and he had on a gray shark skin suit, and he was beautiful. He opened up the class, the rest is history, and I never looked back from my first FOI class I was in, and we didn't have that processing kind of an understanding. We didn't know what a processing class was. We went to work right then on the spot, and I went to work, eventually got registered right there on the spot, and the rest is history.
Wow.
Praise be to Allah.
Praise be to Allah. Please explore the collective9.org website and subscribe to the newsletter. Explore the site and make sure you check out Web TV.